So, so welcome everybody. I will speak about the network effects of Bitcoin and why these network effects will drive Bitcoin to become a dominant standard. So before I start, there's a warning. Listening to this talk might lead to very significant and uncontrolled Bitcoin purchases. And that's exactly what happened to me. It's not a joke. Whenever I worked on the presentation, I couldn't resist and I bought Bitcoin. The Twitter user 100 trillion came up with the so-called stock to flow model, I think 2 years ago. And I think it's important to visit the stock to flow model for a second. The stock to flow model basically says that as the stock to flow increases, so the creation of new assets is being reduced, the price goes up. And the stock to flow model predicts, the stock to flow model actually predicts a 10 time increase with each halving period in the Bitcoin price. And here you see the stock to flow model that shows a Bitcoin price of $100,000 for this halving period. And then with the next halving period, basically another 10 time increase would go up to 1 million. So there's another stock to flow model. It's a stock to flow cross asset model, where the Bitcoin value is correlated to other assets like gold and silver. And basically that stock to flow model predicts $280,000 per Bitcoin for this halving period and then much higher for the next halving period. So what's very strong about the stock to flow model, we see a very, very high correlation between the price and the stock to flow. So R square is really high, and there's also co-integration. And we see, if you look at the dots, even just with eyesight, a strong fit. And it also works with other assets. It's not just Bitcoin, it's also gold and silver and houses and other things. There's also some criticism. It doesn't work for all assets. For example, Bitcoin Cash, and I will revisit this in a second. And another criticism is only supply data. The demand is not included in the model. And then also there's several stock to flow models that all work great, but they come up with very different prices. So let's look at the demand side. I think it's really important. Just, Bitcoin, high valuation. And I think we are, before the dip in May, I think we have a very, very, very close to the prediction of the stock to flow model. And then there's Bitcoin Cash. It has a very low valuation, but it has more or less the same stock to flow. And the technology is almost identical. It's just the block size that's different. So the question really is, does the fact that Bitcoin Cash doesn't fit the model invalidate the model? And I don't think so. I think the model is not complete. And that's what's the talk about is I will complete the model. And the difference between Bitcoin and Bitcoin Cash is the network. So we need to look at the network and the network effects of Bitcoin to fully understand the stock to flow model and the adoption cycle that's behind Bitcoin. So what's the network effect? Basically, the network effect says as the number of users go up, the utility of a product go up. So here we have a car, Volkswagen Golf, most popular car in Germany. And clearly, if more people buy the Volkswagen Golf, there might be scale effects, but the utility of the car doesn't change. It changes maybe a little bit to the upside because there's more repair stations and more information about the car. It also could go down because it's less exclusive. So if you have a Lamborghini and many people have it, then the utility of your Lamborghini might actually go down. So more or less, it's constant. So there's other products and technologies where the utility goes up with adoption. So that's the picture. The more people use it, it continues to go up and it doesn't stop. That's very important. When does it stop? When does decreasing marginal utility set in? And for a very long time, it could go up constantly. So sometimes, you know, it could level off. And the examples, and I will come to more examples in a second, the examples are quite clear. So in communication networks, there's a direct network effect. If there's more users, the more people use it. So if you have email, if you have Telegram, and no one else has it, then it's useless. And if many people have it, then it's useful. And maybe at some point the effect is leveling off. So then there's room for many communication networks. Another very good example is indirect network effects. It's users and complementary products. That was the case in computing operating systems. So very early, there was Windows and a few programs. And then with increasing adoption of Windows, people wrote programs and it became more useful because you could use your computer for many, many more things. And what's really important to understand about the network effects is that there might be at a certain point where newcomers have no room in the market. So the first mover has a technology, a product, it has some utility, but it has already a significant number of adoption of users, so the utility really jumps up. So now, all of a sudden, a new entrant comes to the market, and it might have a better technology. You know, the red column is larger, but less utility based on the adoption, and overall the utility is lower. So it has no chance to be successful in the market. And if that continues, if the first mover continues to grow, and even if better new entrants come to the market and they all fail because their network utility is lower, they have no chance. And that could lead, and I will show some examples in a second, that could lead to the first mover, the leading technology, become a dominant standard. So increasing utility can lead to monopolization, de facto standard, dominant standard, with only one, maybe two, or very, very, very few players in niche markets. And a good example is computing operating systems and payment systems, but also platforms, for example, like eBay. So in the computing space, initially, it looked like Windows would be a monopoly. And actually, it could have been. They saved Apple in the mid-90s from bankruptcy through an investment. And even today, the Apple market share and all the other market shares are very, very low. I think Windows still has a market share of more than 90%. But Windows is not the dominant standard in all of the computing systems. There was a new computing system being established in the last more than 10 years, smartphones. And here you have a different but same picture. Different, Windows is not part of the game, which is very interesting, but the dominant standard is it's a dual standard. It's Android and iOS. And then, of course, there's other computing systems. So basically, the point is increasing network utility can lead to a dominant standard in a certain market segment. And in other very different market segments, there might then be other standards. It's an important point. So what about the network effects of Bitcoin? Let's look at the structure, the picture of Bitcoin. So comparing it to the internet, Bitcoin is a network. Now that's the gray layer. So very clearly, being a network, that there's network effects. It's also a token, the Bitcoin, the currency, and the currency with its use cases might have increasing inherent value, because the use cases add on. And then on top of the network, and you see here on the slide, very slow, very, very small houses, there's an application layer. Just like the internet has a huge application layer with all the names that you see, Facebook and Amazon and all of that. So the value, the potential value of the Bitcoin network could be as the whole value that's attached to the internet combined, all of it together. So the question now is, are there network effects in the Bitcoin space and how do they look like? And there are many network effects. So in the PC space, there were a few network effects. You know, PC producers, applications, know-how, and more or less that's it. And that led to a dominant standard. In the Bitcoin world, there's a huge number of network effects. There's direct network effects, like the number of users. The more people use it, the more useful it can get because you learn about the network. You can send Bitcoin, like communication. And then institutional central banks, wallets, miners, the hash rate, the nodes. It's a direct network effect. The more nodes you have, the more valuable is the Bitcoin network. The higher the hash rate, the more valuable because more secure the network directly becomes. And then there's a huge number, and here a few indirect network effects. So what's an indirect network effect? I said on-ramps, exchanges. You know, the more on-ramps you have, the more users you have, because you can easily on-ramp. The more users you have, the more on-ramps there will be, because it's, you know, the market opens up. So there's a huge number of indirect network effects that keep increasing the value of the network. And then, as you just saw on the previous slide, there are applications on top of the network. So the more applications on top of the network come up, the more valuable the network will be. So second layer applications like Lightning, messaging, Sphinx is a messaging app on top of Lightning, actually the third layer application. Then the identity overlay network from Microsoft, a second layer application regarding identity on top of the Bitcoin blockchain, and potentially many more. And now let's look at a few of these factors. So now here you have from Glassnode, you have the number of active addresses, and they're going up. So that's positive. So there seems to be increasing adoption. And you see the peak around 2017, 2018 with the bubble that we saw at that time. And there you had an exponential adoption, which went down with the correction. And then if you look at the trend line, it looks linear, but I think it's the early phase of an exponential adoption. Same here, number of active addresses. It's again the orange line. It was exponential 2017, and the whole graph looks in its early exponential phase. The hash rate, I think, is very important. And here you see much more advanced compared to the bubble 2017. So again, here we are in the early phase of an exponential adoption. And then number of new entities. So it's all the new players coming to the market, more or less the same picture. So now, and that's the key slide of the presentations. How do these network effects work? So a first look at corporate adoption, because that's what we've seen recently. So corporate adoption, obviously, drives price. Price drives the hash rate because it's more profitable. The hash rate increases security, and then also the nodes also increase security. So it's a very positive feedback loop. So just the corporate adoption with its effect on price, mining, security increases the value of the network. And then we just heard that regulation. The more regulation, the more positive regulation, but also regulation, even if it's not so positive, it provides clarity, it reduces risk. The more regulation, the more corporate adoption. User friendliness, and we just heard a great talk about custody from Stephen. The better the custody solutions, which is for many people difficult to do self-custody, the more user-friendly the whole ecosystem becomes. It drives clearly corporate adoption. Use cases. There's a few use cases, and we've seen, of course, the whole big store of value discussion. that Michael Saylor made very famous, payment, also identity, I just mentioned. The more use cases there are, the more adoption we will have from corporates. And obviously, store of value with the money printing that's going on worldwide, it has a very strong, and that's why you see five pluses, very, very strong utility effect on that one use case, which feeds back into the corporate adoption and price and hash rate and so on. Picture continues. So user-friendliness and custody clearly, clearly drives retail adoption. Retail adoption clearly drives price and corporate adoption. And I'll come to that in a second. Retail and corporate adoption drive trading volume. And the trading volume, and we just heard that also in the previous talk, very deep, very liquid markets provide great benefit, great benefit for retail and for corporates. Because if you want to sell, you can easily sell around the clock, not just very limited hours. And then it's information, conferences like these, increasing adoption of these conferences, participants drive the utility, drive adoption of corporates and retail. It goes on. Retail adoption drives itself. So if everybody of my friends buys Bitcoin, I even if I don't believe in it, I start buying Bitcoin. Money printing also, of course, drives retail adoption, negative interest rates. People don't know what to do with their money. They might just buy a Bitcoin strongly. It continues. Use cases not only drive corporate adoption, obviously they also drive retail adoption. And with payment and integration in existing products, and we've heard that also, PayPal has integrated, Revolut has integrated. There's a job ad from Apple out where it looks like that they might be integrating crypto payments in the App Store. That clearly drives retail adoption. I mentioned second layer applications, and I would like to add compatible finance solutions. So Binance and others, Nuri, our portfolio company, but also others have Visa cards that charge against a crypto wallet. And Binance, especially, I think they're creating an increasing network in their universe themselves. So, and then there's many, many more. Developers, Bitcoin acceptance sites, and I think that's the largest driver in the whole system, central bank adoption. We will have central banks, and maybe they're already buying in Iran and in other places, but we will have big central banks like the Swiss National Bank and the ECB adopting Bitcoin at some point. And if you look at the picture, you see a huge number of positive feedback loops, increasing the utility and increasing adoption and increasing price. And it's not just one or two or few feedback loops, it's many. And that's just part of the picture. And that picture also shows the risk. So if your regulation will be very, very negative, extremely negative, that would create a negative feedback loop into the system. If security became an issue, and that's why the hash rate, I think, is really important, and not proof of stake, but proof of work. If security became an issue, then it could create a negative negative impulse in the whole thing. You also see in that picture, there will be bubbles all the time. And these bubbles then, of course, will deflate. So the feedback loop between price and adoption, price goes up, I buy more, price goes up, I buy more, will create limited bubbles. And that will always happen, whatever. So that picture is the key, and I'm almost done. The picture is the key. We will see a huge number of positive feedback loops driving adoption and driving price. So what's the so what? The stock to flow model is not complete. I'll add increasing network effects. And with increasing network effects, we will have the Bitcoin protocol and the token becoming the dominant protocol of the Internet of Value. And it will be much, much larger than the use case store of value, which is 100 trillion over roughly 20 million Bitcoin, which will lead to $5 million per Bitcoin. It will be much, much larger than that, because there will be many, many, many other use cases. It will take a while because the system needs to work through it. And that's the perspective. That's the perspective: increasing feedback loops, becoming a dominant standard, and exploding in value and price. Thank you very much.